Hi, I'm Shirley Adams, and I'm back with the Sewing Connection Series 8, Program 10. When you sew, you use a needle constantly, but can you handle two needles as one? Very easily if they're both attached to the same shank and used in your machine. Maybe utilitarian, usually decorative. Let's see what we can do with them. Now, if you sew very much on knits, this is the perfect place to start out with a twin needle. You're going to find it very useful in doing the hems. So down here I have a hem using a twin needle, both in the jacket, and you can see the back side. There's a little raw edge here. You can finish it before you twin needle stitch it down if you want to, but it's not going to ravel, so I didn't choose to. Here it's also used in the pants. Let's see how easy that is to do and how that twin needle works. Now, first of all, consider what foot you're going to use, what needles you're going to use, and what I have down here is a foot that has a little raised place under it. What I have on the machine is a foot that's perfectly flat on the bottom because I don't want any raised place really in this knit. It's not going to be decorative. It's strictly utilitarian here. So I just have the standard presser foot on, the all-purpose foot. And then if you really want little raised places created by the twin needles, you use this grooved foot. And because of those grooves on the underside, they permit the fabric to go up inside there and make pretty little raised places. So this is the decorative type. You'd use this foot for it. Well, if we're just going to put a hem in this little piece of fabric, what we need to do is find out on our machine how deep that hem can be, because you're going to stitch it on the right side of the fabric and not on the wrong side. So I'd test it out by, first of all, just putting it in the machine here to see how far over, what little slot, what little marking on my throat plate I could use in order to not stitch off the edge of this hem. And I find I can stitch way over here to the last marking on it, but just to be safe, I'll go a little bit shallower to make sure that I do catch it. And this is just easy stitching. Okay, let's thread the machine though before we do this. And of course I've already threaded it rather than take time to thread the two needles while we're on camera. To thread it on mine is very easy because I have two different spool pins here, one in back and one up here on top. So I've simply put the two spools on and threaded it through. Now if you only have one spool pin, even then you can do this by perhaps putting a straw, a drinking straw, over that spool pin and putting the two spools on it. Or another way you can do it is if you have two spool pins coming off the top but they're kind of close together, then it's a good idea to have those spools wind off in different directions so that they won't interfere with each other. But once you have that on the spools, then as you thread it, it goes through the very same way. The two of them go all the way together, except right wherever your tension discs are. So here's the tension on this machine. So I just have one of the threads going between these two discs and the other thread going between the other two. This is the only place they separate. Other than that, they're just threaded the usual way. And when they come down here then, of course, they're threaded through the two different needles. And if you mix them up and have one on the left and one on the right, it doesn't matter. It's going to be all right. It'll separate itself as it comes down here. So to stitch this, we simply stitch it. And I do have it, no I don't, let me loosen it because I'm stitching on a knit, so I want to loosen the pressure on the presser foot so it won't scoot the top layer along. And you can see as it stitches this, I don't need such small stitches, so I'll get a little bigger here. Because usually you do want those stitches to kind of show, and you probably would use them a little bigger. And I'm just doing this with the same marking on my throat plate so that I can get an even line. And when you get to the other end, what this looks like on the back side, and this will explain if you haven't used this twin needle yet, this will explain how it works. Now I've used three different colors of thread. There's a red and a white here on top, so you can see those two. But what happens on the bobbin is you still just have one bobbin in this machine. Nothing's different there. So what that bobbin thread does is go back and forth and catch the two top threads, so it looks a little like a zigzag on the back. Now this is one of the reasons it's nice for knits, because it'll permit it to stretch because of that zigzag that's produced on the back as it catches the two top threads. So it works beautifully. If you come in too far and have all this extra that I have here, you'd simply trim off the excess when you get through hemming it, and it's going to make a very nice hem. Now this was a commercial skirt that I have down here. It was a sweater knit. and it was simply too long. It was going to be much easier, much better to cut it off at the waist instead of at the bottom, which already had a finished knit edge. So I was just trying out here to see what would happen, and it works very well. It looks almost the same as the commercial. Now, what I have here in the machine are needles, the two of them on one shank, and they're 2.5 millimeters apart. What I have down here on the table is an assortment of them. Here's one, for instance, and it says on the package that it's only 2 millimeters apart. So this is exactly what it means. If I'd put this down on a little measuring stick, you can see it goes between two little markings there. So this is 2 millimeter. It also comes in 2.5, 3 point, 4 point. This 4 point, which is very far apart or quite wide, this actually is what I used when I did this knit waistband because I wanted really wide stitching to look pretty much like the commercial did. So what I found easy to do with this is, first of all, just attach all this elastic with the serger. I put the elastic on first, and then to actually hem it down, I used that 4 millimeter needle so that it's pretty far apart and just stitched over this. So an easy little thing. You can do almost everything you see done commercially on your own machine if you just play around with it a little bit and figure it out. But most of the time we use twin needles, they're used decoratively. So let's see a blouse over here where I'd actually do that decorative stitching. Now I've cut this out. I really don't know how it's going to turn out or how much it's going to condense as I do this stitching. Therefore, what I'm going to do on this is, first of all, just cut it out a lot bigger than it needs to be. And you can see with this pattern that's on top of it, what I've done is cut it out up to this point. The rest of it isn't cut out yet. I'm going to do the stitching on it, and then I'm going to put the pattern on again after I'm finished and trim off the excess that I have there. That's the safe way to do it, instead of trying to figure out how much extra do you need. This one's already been partially stitched. It doesn't really condense a whole lot, I found, because I did, about 10 rows perhaps here and tried the pattern on again, and it didn't come down terribly far. So I was a bit generous with this. So you can see you don't need a whole lot of extra. But what you want to do to start is just press a little crease, which I've done over on this side. I've pressed a crease right about where the notch is going to be in the arm's eye. That means right about at this level, above the bust level, up here in the high chest, is where I'm going to have all these pin tucks, and they're just going to start here and go on up toward the shoulder. How high? I don't know. I have plenty of fabric, so as many as I feel like doing, I can put in there. But this also, we would pin tuck like this, and this time I want those pin tucks to show. So I'm going to not use the flat foot that I have on right now, the all-purpose foot. I'm instead going to put on it that foot with the grooves underneath so that the fabric will raise into the grooves and produce a pretty little raised finish there. Now naturally, I'm just doing this temporarily. I'm going to take it out because on my blouse, I really don't want all those different colors. I want it to be all white. So using this line that I pressed as a marking, I'll stitch this and it'll do the same thing as the hem, except it's going to pull a little groove up into the foot. And so when this is all finished, you can definitely see that this is a pin tuck, a twin needle pin tuck is what it's called. And after I would do one of these, you can see already how it pulls the fabric up. And you can see on the other side how it's made that pretty little pin tuck. So they're nice and uniform. They come out looking exactly the same every time. This is a great process and a pretty one. For children's clothes, for adult clothes, it doesn't matter, but it's something you might want to try. This is used a lot in heirloom sewing, a combination of pin tucks with maybe lace or entredeau or whatever else you put with it. So it is a pretty little addition that you might want to make, but you can see again how that lower thread just grabs the two upper threads and zigzags between them to produce that pin tuck. The second one then, you don't need to press any more lines. From then on, progressively, you just put the foot next to the first one and keep on stitching up there. Or if you want them real close together, you can put that first one inside one of the grooves and get really close pin tucks there. I have a couple of things on the rack that have these pin tucks in so you can see what they look like. Now this does well on both fabric of this sort that's just very lightweight, this blouse fabric. And first of all, I cut out a rectangle here, did all these pin tucks, then I put the pattern on to cut out the bib and put it together. But all these pin tucks worked well on the lightweight fabric. I probably had one of the 2 millimeter needles there so that they'd be pretty close together. But it also works well on heavy fabric. Here's ultra suede. Denim would do the job nicely. And why I used pin tucks on here is because I wanted to get the shape that darts had. This pattern actually had darts in it, not these pin tucks. But I put a lot of pin tucks that are little short ones and then only a few ones that are long. This simulates then the same shape when it's on your body as the dart would that has a wide base up here, but just a very small narrow point. So this works out the very same way. How I did this was do one line right in the center and did a pin tuck there, and then I just kept alternating back and forth. Every few pin tucks I'd try it on my tummy to see, is it ready yet or does it need a few more to fit the same way as the darts would into the appointed space. So that's how this was done. Again, just a very easy process. But something I really want to show you that is not too difficult, but it's spectacular. It isn't mine. It is something just beautiful that I have here on the rack. Now, we've been tap dancing around this jacket. You've already seen it modeled on one or two shows by our models. And so I finally want to explain what this is all about and show it to you in depth. What this is some gorgeous, it looks like a heavy jacket, it's not. It's some beautiful fabric. It possibly started out white silk. Is what it is. It would be suitable for blouse silk. It's really quite thin. There isn't much thickness here at all. So it's starting out with that fabric. And then there's an artist. Remember I said last week at the end of the show that we were going to go international. We were going to go from Australia to New Zealand to England to Fiji, all over and end up in LA. Well, that's what this one man who paints the fabric has done. He's actually of East Indian descent. And a little of this shows in his work. The Near East influence does, but then he has been also in the other part of the world, down under, around Australia and New Zealand, where he was educated. And now he has turned up, for the last 25 years, he's been in Los Angeles. The name of this man is Douglas Ram Samuj, and he just does beautiful things. Now, I can't paint like this, but what he does, and he does this for a lot of the big name designers, what he does is, first of all, paint his fabric by his process that only he knows how to do. And then after it's beautifully painted with muted colors, influenced by whatever period in history he wants it to be influenced by, after he has that all painted and it's all dried, then he uses something that I've had for years on my bookshelves in my sewing room. These blocks, these are print blocks from India. And what he has done, printed over the top of his painted fabric, he has put some gold, some metallic paint on this. And then after he has all this inked down with the metallic, then it's a matter of pressing it here and there. Now the block that he used, you can see down here, has a slight circular pattern in it. And it's just sort of muted. It isn't very definite prints the way most prints are. It's just sort of muted. He's put it down lightly here and there on it. So some of that circle shows up. Other places it doesn't really. It just looks like a slight filigree or a little marbleized finish over the top. But because he did that circular block print, because he used that, then the person who designed and made this jacket, Janet Penwell from Indianapolis, things truly are international, aren't they? And cross-continental and so on. They go everywhere. Okay, what Janet has done then is she designed this jacket. After it was all made and trimmed beautifully with a complimentary silk around the edges here, what she has done is take that circular idea that he has done with the block print, and she's done that same thing here with twin needle, which made a really, really pretty line. Now, to make a perfect circle like this with a twin needle is going to be maybe a little hard for you to manipulate unless you get a little help, which is what we're going to do. Some of you with your machines might have a circular stitcher. Others of you, if you don't have that, can do this without very easily. All you need is, besides the fabric you're going to use, and what I have here is also some painted fabric, not done as elaborately. This one was done by machine very inexpensively and bought by the yard. It's actually a painted denim. And with this painted denim. In fact, I think you're going to see this painted denim next week, perhaps. With that, she has used metallic thread. I see she has two spools of metallic thread here on the top. She's used gold in both those spools, not a contrast or not two different ones. And what she uses on the bottom is insignificant because it's not going to show. It's only the top that shows. But here's some metallic thread, and this would be similar to what she has used there. It comes, of course, in many colors, so you can take your choice. Now, I'm not going to re-thread the machine because you can see it better. This is so subtle when it's done in the metallics. It doesn't really show all that much. And it's pretty that way, of course. It's richer that way when it's very subtle instead of a blast at you. So this is done very nicely. I'm going to do it with the threads that I already have in there so that you can see it. But I'm going to do this with the aid of a thumbtack. And I have that thumbtack on some tape, and the tack end of it, the sharp end's coming through the tape, and I'm then going to tack it onto the bed of my machine. Now I can produce two different patterns here, different stitch patterns, by where I tack it. If I tack it on one side, for instance, if I want to do those same little scallops that Janet has done on hers. If I tack it on one side, it'll have the scallops going around like this in the circle. If I tack it on this side, it'll have the scallops coming out to a point as it goes around the circle. So you take your choice, you can do it either way. I think I'll tack it out here where you can see it better. And you can't tack it just any old place. You have to tack it either to the left or the right of the needle and of the presser foot. So I'll tack it over here. And I'm then going to put this fabric in the hoop. And this will go underneath, and the hoop spring will go on top. And let's see what happens with this. This is fun to play around with. Some rainy day when you just need to, when you have a little time to spend, see the magnificent things you can do with this. Okay, once I have this in the hoop, I'm going to put it, I want to have that grooved foot, so that's fine. I'm going to just raise this presser foot a little extra high so that I can get the hoop under it. And then I'm going to, where do you want the center of the circle? That's where you put the thumbtack. So I'll put that, almost in the center of the hoop, not quite, right here. Now make sure that you don't get that thumbtack too far away. For instance, if you'd put it way over here in the corner, you wouldn't have a big enough hoop to work this on the machine. So it usually is kind of smallish circles. I would guess that Janet's circle is probably about, almost 6 inches big. So that meant that her center was 3 inches away from the needles is how the center happened. Mine's about, an inch and a half, 2 inches away. Now, I found in practicing this to see how it would work that it was a little bit easier to do if I would just put a little piece of cardboard on top of the fabric, stick it through the, and it would hold it there just a little bit better. And then what this little cardboard is, by the way, is just cut off a bias tape card. So this is what I used. You could also, if you wanted to, put a cork on top of it maybe to hold it in place, but it holds the fabric down a little bit better. Then as we stitch this, let's do a straight stitch first of all, and that's what she has outlining her. So I'll just do a straight stitch to see how that works, and then we'll move it a little bit to see how a decorative pattern would look. Now see how this is just moving all by itself because that is taped there in place, the thumbtack is, and so it nicely goes around in a circle. So it makes a very pretty little design. Because I have that grooved foot, it'll raise a little bit. I still have mine set on 2 for the knit fabric. Why don't I put it up to 6? More pressure on the presser foot, and maybe it'll pull that groove up a little more. Now it will pull up more after I take it out of the hoop. Right now it doesn't want to groove up too much because the hoop's keeping it stretched out very tautly. Let's do a decorative stitch though. I'm going to push this button because we want to have a little scallop there the way she has done on her jacket. So let's see what that scallop is. Now on your machine there may not be any allowance for a twin needle, but as long as you have a wide throat plate, it'll probably do the job, a wide hole in the presser foot as well as the throat plate so that the two needles can get down. Be careful though about the decorative stitches to decide how wide they can be. For instance, with this scallop, I have pushed a button here that says twin needle, and so it won't even allow me to get too big. If I would be using on this stitch a single needle, I might be able to stitch this wider. But this automatically makes me stitch it a little bit narrower so that it won't hit the sides of the presser foot and break the needles. So think about that and try it very carefully if you don't have that capability. Then once you dial that stitch, see how wide it actually will go by turning the balance wheel by hand to make sure that you don't, with any force, have the needles hit that. Okay, I have mine on this, so let's see what happens now that we're doing that scallop stitch. And you can see it is scalloping. And it just does very nicely all by itself as long as we let that thumbtack work for us. And you can see that scallop, can you? So it just works out very, very nicely, very easily. Let your machine work for you as long as you have all these different capabilities, which this isn't very fancy. Actually, anybody's machine almost will do something like this as long as you can dial a few stitch patterns. So here's one capability. Now I find that right now it is only going about 3 point is the width that this is going. This same design would go up to 6 point, I notice, really wide, if I had a single needle instead of this twin needle. What I have found also, though, in experimenting is the fact that if I would take off this grooved foot, because it won't allow me to go any wider than this, and if I'd put on a super wide foot, I still can't go up quite as wide as 6, but I find I can with this one, without even moving the threads here, I can go up as wide as 5, so I'll just push it down to 5, and I'll then have, with this foot, a deeper scallop, so it'll be more pronounced now. So, all kinds of capabilities if you just try out all your different machine workings. Get that thread out of the way, and you can see these are now deeper scallops, more pronounced ones, bigger ones. So try any of the decorative stitches and see what they'll do, not only in a circle, but some other ways as well. But do be sure that you see how wide you can get, or you're going to have broken needles there very easily. Well, what I love so much about this jacket is its subtlety. I love the fact that any of you who sew can be artists, maybe not to this degree, but you can all do some pretty things. So let's try it out. Let's see what those machines will do. We're going to be seeing this again, so it's not farewell forever to this jacket. You'll see it again on another show before the series ends. But I'll hang it up back here because I want to show you some other capabilities. Now, besides what I've done so far, I find that I can do this on many different fabrics. I always like to try it on a sample first to make sure I know what I'm doing. But I find even on this fabuleather, I'm going to make a blue fabuleather jacket. And on this one, I find that the twin needle works beautifully. I saw this done on a designer leather jacket, and it had a whole lot of stripes on the sleeves done with twin needle. So I tried it here. It's going to work on mine. What I did as I tried this out is make little notes for myself because I wanted to know what stitch width and what needle width, what everything was, so that when I get back to it later, I know which one of these I want to use. So do that because you're not going to remember it otherwise. So it does that well on any kind of fabric. On this, for instance, I'm in the process of making another dress, and I'll just take this, my thumbtack off, so that I can show you how to turn a corner, because I'm in the process of making another dress, and what I have down here on the table that I'll show you in a second is just the yoke part, because it's going to have a yoke up above, and it's going to have then the dress down below. And I decided what would be very pretty on this yoke, and I'll put my grooved foot back on because I do want to have a more pronounced pintuck on this. Let's see, am I up as high as I can get? Yes, I am. Okay, and get this grooved foot back on. Okay, I want to have that little pronounced groove here, and this is what I've done on this yoke. It's just the whole thing. It goes all the way around in a square here, and it's a matter of turning these corners once you get to them. How are you going to do that? So, what I'm going to do is try a little bit and see how easily I can turn a corner. I don't want that stitch pattern anymore, although you can do any of those decorative stitch patterns right now, but I just want straight stitch. So I'll put it back to straight, and at the same time, I put it back to twin needle, and I'm going to also make a little bit bigger stitches here. They don't need to be quite this small. But let's just see, as we stitch down to the corner, how we can turn it. Okay, whenever I get to where I want to go, I have the needle down right now, but I'm not going to keep it that way. Usually when you turn a corner, you want that needle down position because then you can pick up the presser foot and just turn the fabric. And look what happens when I try to turn this. The needles stay in the position they were, so it isn't going to work. So what I need to do is move that needle up. And then very carefully, I'm going to turn this corner, and I'm going to put the needle back down so that it goes in the very same place where it came up. I want it at that back line, the white thread line is where I'm putting it. And once I have it placed right where I want it, then I can just stitch forward. And this is how you can turn a corner, or many corners, if you're going instead of in a curve or a straight line. Okay, so we've turned a corner, and that makes it easy. And here again, to do repeated rows, I would just use the edge of the presser foot as I have the distances all regulated in between them. But while we just have a plain piece of fabric here, let's do a little bit with some of the other decorative stitches that are possible and see how they work out with a twin needle. Let's see what happens, for instance, if we put this in a zigzag pattern, in a satin stitch pattern, and see what happens then. It could work out very nicely, and here again, I'm going to try to see exactly what happens here. Okay, I'm on satin stitch, and it does work out nicely. Well, anyway, try some of this. It's wonderful fun. I love to see what truly talented people can do, like that jacket, with lovely fabric and inspired techniques. A baseball jacket doesn't sound terribly artistic, but by piecing, quilting, wrinkling, or otherwise manipulating the fabric, you can bring in a home run. Join me at the ballpark next time for Mixed Media.